Welcome back. Today, I will be reading aloud to you. It's been a little while since I've done a read aloud from this wonderful book, Birds That Every Child Should Know by Neltje Blanchan, published in 1907. And I have read aloud quite a few chapters from this book. That was kind of my bread and butter back in the beginning when I was starting my channel. I'm very grateful for this book, for giving me something interesting to read on my channel. Interesting to me anyway, and hopefully relaxing to you. So you can check out previous chapters if you would like. I will link to a playlist if you are really into learning about the birds, or if you just would like multiple hours of read aloud for background. That could be fun. So today, I'm really into the texture of this book today. Maybe I'll have to do a whole video just tapping on it instead of reading from it. But today, we are going to be reading chapter, in suspense because I don't remember myself which chapter it is. We have read a lot of chapters from this book, so we're all the way up to, my goodness, we're all the way up to chapter 9, the Blackbird family. Bobolink, Red-Winged Blackbird, Rusty Blackbird, Meadowlark, Orchard Oriole, Baltimore Oriole, Purple and Bronzed Grackles. Bobolink, called also Reed Bird, Rice Bird, Ortolan, May Bird. Such a rollicking, jolly singer is the bobolink. On a May morning, when buttercups spangle the fresh grasses in the meadows, he rises from their midst into the air with the merriest frolic of a song you ever heard. Loud, clear, strong, full of queer kinks and twists that could not possibly be written down in our musical scale, the rippling, reckless music seems to keep his wings in motion as well as his throat. For when it suddenly bursts forth, up he shoots into the air like a skylark and paddles himself along with just the tips of his wings, while it is the mad music that seemingly propels him. Then he drops with his song down into the grass again. Frequently, he pours out his hilarious melody while swaying on the slender stems of the grasses, propped by the stiff pointed feathers of his tail. A score or more of bobolinks rising in some open meadow all day long are worth traveling miles to hear. If you were to see the mate of one of these merry minstrels apart from him, you might easily mistake her for another of those tiresome sparrows. A brown, streaked bird with some buff and a few white feathers, she shades into the colors of the ground as well as they and covers her loose heap of twigs, leaves, and grasses in the hayfield so harmoniously that few people ever find it, or the clever sitter. As early as the 4th of July, bobolinks begin to desert the choir, being the first birds to leave us. Traveling southward by easy stages, they feed on the wild rice in the marshes until, late in August, enormous flocks reach the cultivated rice fields of South Carolina and Georgia. On the way, a great transformation has gradually taken place in the male bobolink's dress. At the north, he wore a black, buff, and white wedding garment, with the unique distinction of being lighter above than below. But this he has exchanged, feather by feather, for a striped, brown, sparrowy winter suit like his mates and children's, only with a little more buff about it. In this inconspicuous dress, the reed birds, or rice birds, as bobolinks are usually called south of Mason and Dixon's line, descend in hordes upon the rice plantations when the grain is in the milk and do several millions of dollars worth of damage to the crop every year, sad, sad to tell. Bobolinks leave this country by way of Florida and continue their 4,000-mile journey to southern Brazil, just to return to us by the same route in May. By this time, the males have made another complete change of feather to go a-courting. Most birds are content to molt once a year, just after nursery duties have ended. Some, it is true, put on a partially new suit in the following spring, retaining only their old wing and tail feathers. But a very few, the bobolink, goldfinch, and scarlet tanager among them, undergo as complete a change as harlequin. Red-winged blackbird, called also swamp blackbird. When you are looking for the first pussy willows in the frozen marshes, or listening to the peeping of young frogs someday in early spring, you will no doubt become acquainted with this handsome blackbird, with red and orange on his shoulders, who has just returned from the south. Kay, kong, keree, he flutes from the willows and alders about the reedy meadows, where he and his bachelor friends flock together and make them ring with social cheer and jubilee. A little later, flocks of dingy, brown, streaked birds traveling northward pause to rest in the marshes. Wholesale courting takes place shortly after, and every red wing in a black uniform chooses one of the plain, streaked, matter-of-fact birds for his mate. The remainder continue their journey in search of husbands, whom they find waiting in cheerful readiness in almost any marsh. By the 1st of May, all have settled down to home life. Then how constant are the rich, liquid, sweet, okalee notes of the redwing. Ever in foolish fear for the safety of his nest, he advertises its whereabouts in musical headlines from the top of the nearest tree, or circles around it on fluttering wings above the sedges, or chucks at any trespasser near it until one might easily torture him by going straight to its site. But how short-lived is this excessive devotion to his family. In July, the restless young birds flock with the mothers, but the now indifferent fathers keep apart by themselves. Strange conduct for such fussy, solicitous birds. They congregate in large numbers where the wild rice is ripening and make short excursions to the farmers' fields, where they destroy some grain, it is true, but so little as compared with the quantity of injurious insects and weed seed that the debt is largely in the Red Wing's favor. Rusty Blackbird, called also Thrush Blackbird. This cousin of the Red Wing, whom it resembles in size, flight, and notes, is a common migrant in the United States. Nesting is done farther north. In spring, the rusty blackbirds come from the south in pairs, already mated, whereas the Red Wings and Grackles travel then in flocks. At that time, the males are a uniform, glossy, bluish black, and their mates a slate gray, darker above than below. But after the summer molt, when they gather in small companies, both are decidedly rusty. You might mistake them for grackles in the spring. Notice the rusty blackbird's pale yellow eye. Meadowlark, called also Old Field Lark, Meadow Starling. Every farmer's child knows his father's friend, the meadowlark, the brownish, mottled bird, larger than a robin, with a lovely yellow breast and black crescent on it, that keeps well hidden in the grass of the meadows or grain fields. Of course, he knows, too, that it is not really a lark, but a starling. When the shy bird takes wing, note the white feathers on the sides of its tail, to be sure it is not the big brownish flicker, who wears a patch of white feathers on its lower back, conspicuous as it flies. The meadowlark has the impolite habit of turning its back upon one, as if it thought its yellow breast too beautiful for human eyes to gaze at. It flaps and sails through the air, much like a bobwhite. But flying is not its specialty. It is, however, a strong-legged, active walker, and rarely rises from the ground, unless an intruder gets very near, when away it flies with a nasal sputtered alarm note to alight upon a fence rail or other low perch. The tender, sweet, plaintive, flute-like whistle, Spring o' the Year, is a deliberate song usually given from some favorite platform, a stump, a rock, a fence or a mound, to which the bird goes for his musical performance only. He sings on and on delightfully, not always the same song, for he has several in his repertoire, and charms all listeners, although he cares to please none but his mate, that looks just like him. Orchard Oriole. Fortunately, many other birds besides this oriole prefer to live in orchards. Otherwise, think how many worm-eaten apples there would be. He usually has the kingbird for company, and strange to say, keeps on friendly terms with a rather exclusive fellow. Also the robin, the bluebird, the cedar waxwing, and several other feathered neighbors who show a preference for fruit trees when it is time to nest. You may know the orchard oriole's cradle by its excellent weaving. It is not a deep, swinging pouch like the Baltimore Oriole's, but a well-rounded cup, more like a vireo's, formed of grasses of nearly even length and width, cut green and woven with far more skill and precision than a basket made by a boy or girl is apt to be. Look for it near the end of a limb, 10 to 20 feet up. It is by no means easily seen when the green grassy cup matches the color of the leaves. The mother oriole is so harmoniously dressed in grayish olive green, more yellowish underneath, that you may scarcely notice her as she glides among the trees. But her mate is more conspicuous. However quietly dressed in black and reddish chestnut, even somberly dressed as compared with his flashy orange and black cousin, the Baltimore Oriole. Nevertheless, it takes him 2 or possibly 3 years to attain his fine clothes. By that time, his song is rich, sweet, and strong. Do Orioles generally take special delight in the music of a piano? An orchard oriole who used to come close to our house to feed on the basket worms dangling from a nearby bush returned long after the last worm had been eaten whenever someone touched the keys. And I have known more than one Baltimore oriole to fly about the house joyously singing, as if attracted and excited by the music indoors. Baltimore oriole. Called also firebird, golden robin, hang nest, golden oriole. A flash of flame among the tender young spring foliage, a rich, high, whistled song from the blossoming cherry trees, and every child knows that the sociable Baltimore oriole has just returned from Central America. Brilliant orange and black feathers like this could no more be concealed than the fiery little redstarts. And as if they alone were not enough to advertise his welcome presence in the neighborhood, he keeps up a rich, ringing, insistent whistle that you can quickly learn to imitate. You have often started all the roosters in your neighborhood to crowing, no doubt. Even so, you can whistle up the mystified orioles, who are always disposed to live near our homes. Although the Baltimore oriole has a southern name, he is really more common at the north, whereas the orchard oriole is more at home south of New England. Lady Baltimore, who wears a yellowish olive dress with dusky wings and tail, has the reputation of being one of the finest nest builders in the world. To the end of a branch of some tall shade tree, preferably an elm or willow, although almost any large tree on a lawn or roadside may suit her, she carries grasses, plant fiber, string, or bits of cloth. These she weaves and felts into a perfect bag 6 or 7 inches deep and lines it with finer grasses, hair, and wool. A safe, cozy swinging cradle for her babies. But, as you may imagine, those babies have a rather hard time when they try to climb out of it into the world. Many a one tumbles to the ground, unable to hold on to the tip of a swaying twig and not being strong enough to fly. Then what a tremendous fuss the parents make. They cannot carry the youngster up into the tree. They are in deadly fear of cats. They are too worried and excited to leave him alone, but the plucky little fellow usually hops toward the tree and with the help of his sharp claws on the rough bark, flutters his way up safely to the first limb. The purple and bronzed grackles, also called crow blackbirds. You probably know either one of our 2 crow blackbirds, similar in size and habits, one with purplish iridescent plumage, the commonest grackle east of the Alleghenies and south of Massachusetts, and the bronzed grackle with brassy tints in his black plumage, who overruns the western country and from Massachusetts northward. Both have uncanny yellow eyes that make you suspect their motives. Their mates are a trifle smaller and dull. When the trees are still leafless in earliest spring and the ground is brown and cold, flocks of blackbirds dot the bare trees or take shelter from March winds among their favorite evergreens, or walk solemnly about on the earth like small crows, feeding on fat white grubs and beetles in a businesslike way. They are singularly joyless birds, a croaking, wheezy whistle like the sound of a cartwheel that needs axle grease, expresses whatever pleasure they may have in life. Always sociable, living in flocks the entire year throughout, it is in autumn only that they band together in enormous numbers, and in the West especially, do serious havoc in the cornfields. However, they do incalculable good as insect destroyers, so the farmers must forgive these clever maize thieves. And I will show you, there aren't a lot of photographs in this book. Here is a very old photo of some orchard orioles. Yes, young. Thank you for being here with me and learning about the blackbirds. Take good care of yourself.